You're listening to the SWN podcast.
And this is SWN.
Welcome to SWN.
Skull! Skull! Skull!
This is SWN.
And this is the Scottish Wrestling Network.
Where Scottish wrestling lives, I guess. Is that a tagline? I guess. I don't know.
Hello and welcome to the SWN podcast. I'm your host, as always, Billy. We're into season 7. This is technically the first recording for season 7. I think it's going to be episode 4 by the time it actually comes out. I am joined by a very special guest. For people that are in the Scottish wrestling scene, they may not have heard of the name, Keita Murray. But I've known this man for quite a long time, and we're going to get into it. We're going to talk about all sorts of things because this is coming out WrestleMania weekend, even though Elimination Chamber hasn't happened yet as of recording. So this is very interesting. Yeah. We could make some wild accusations of things that aren't happening, just not happening during that time. Anyway, I've said his name. Welcome to the show, Keita Murray.
What's up, Billy, my man?
I'm so excited for this.
I don't think we've ever talked video. I know I've always seen promos from you against me, but I've never talked live.
That's it. I think that's the only time to be honest, it's taken me about 10 years to remember how to say your name correctly, because I think all the promos that was Keita or Keita or something like that. So
yeah.
It's nice to actually be able to say your name properly. And you know what did it? When your username, your Twitter name, X whatever, is Keita your heart. I was like, that's how you say it. Cool. It.
Yeah.
Took a while.
It's awesome.
how's it going?
It's been good. I can't complain. Within the 10 or even more so years that we've known each other, it's been a long journey. Mm-hmm. Very long journey. But it's been good. I can't complain. You know, life is definitely at its good point right now. So I can't complain at all.
So for those unaware in the old Scottish sphere, if they're podcast fans, they'll know that I did a Blast from the Past episode last year, I think it was, or year before, where I watched some old Ask Billy episodes. They were terrible. But when you scroll through it, there's still an Ask K-Man episode on YouTube, if you're hopefully aware of this.
Yeah. I did one. I forgot about that. Yeah, I did do one.
So, and K-Man's Corner is in there as well. There's some stuff I just can't get scrubbed off the internet, unfortunately.
Hey, that's okay. Let these people see who I was back then as a teenager, and now I'm a grown man, so it's okay. I remember those are fun, though, the Ask Billies, and then when I did the Ask K-Man, that was fun, you know, because, like, that was my first, like, back then, you know, there wasn't any type of, like, influencer recording. Like, you probably, like, set the standard, you know what I mean? Because, like, there wasn't much of, like, you know, of people talking about wrestling through videos or anything, or, like, or even about, so, because then you mixed it up, so sometimes it was, like, personal life and things of that, but most of it was wrestling, you know? So, like, it's crazy to see where you were and how we started at first. Like, you know, we thought this was kind of, like, not weird, but it just wasn't like the thing to do. Now you fucking go on X and literally everyone's showing their own fucking opinion about wrestling through a video, and it's like, shut the fuck up. But you know, so it's crazy how much wrestling has evolved since then.
Yeah, that's right. Because Bebo, we met through Bebo. Through a group called Old School Wrestling. It was run by Davin Malloy and it was myself as well. I was in there, and some YouTuber called Jay Hunter was involved as well.
He does podcasts now himself, right?
Just one of the biggest on Patreon. I think is OSW Review. One day we'll reach the heavy heights of OSW Review numbers.
Cool.
And you're right, Bebo had a little box in the corner, and I'd put up a video every so often answering questions and things like that. And we started this whole little thing between myself and Kevin Morrison as Murray Mafia, and yourself and Jeffrey Show Live, Jeffrey Taylor himself, doing back and forth promos, like e-fedding, but with promos.
Yeah.
What were we thinking?
I don't know. I don't know. To be honest with you, I thought it would get me ready to do promos when I actually started wrestling, but no, not at all. I was still as terrible.
Oh man, that's just the wildest thing about it. Because yeah, if I look back on them and I was really confident about doing them, I couldn't imagine doing that now because of, like you're saying, you go on Twitter or X and there's someone's got their fucking opinion of something.
And literally, I'm thinking,
oh God, if I did anything like that now, I would just get dragged for comment after comment after comment. But back 15 years ago, wherever it was okay. It was a safe place.
It was. That's what was nice about it too, you know? So like, that was our little like go-to, you know? I remember just when I went to Facebook, I would always just be on there, like on the Facebook page all day long, just like, you know, waiting for the next discussion to be talked about, the next topic, you know, and just like wanting to chime in because it was so exciting, you know what I mean? It was like nothing that you've seen at that time because, you know, I was in high school at that time too, so no one in my school talked about wrestling. It was very like, it was still at the stages of like after the Attitude Era, after the Ruthless Aggression Era, where it was very, this wrestling's not funny anymore. We know it's fake, you know, this, that, and the third. Like, if you watch wrestling, you're pretty much gay, you know what I mean? Or there's something, you're a weirdo, you know? But so that was like my sanctuary of like being able to just talk about wrestling, you know what I mean? And like, cause I couldn't do it anywhere else, you know? And that was it.
That's it, yeah. And pretty much I was the same, cause it was, we were in that awkward period where wrestling wasn't cool. And you guys were kind of my safe space of going, right, who, or whatever terrible discussion that was brought up. I still remember there was the discourse of Stephanie McMahon and Velvet Sky. I remember these days of, I think, shut down one version of SW because it got very heated. But we'll come back to that because we'll go right back to the start. We'll get the usual interview questions out of the way just so we've got a little bit of a backstory of Keita Murray. How did you get into wrestling? So you said you didn't have any friends that liked wrestling, so how did you get exposed to it?
So shout out to Poi. I wanted to say that because can't do this without my man Poi. I think we mentioned everybody else, but my man Poi. But to get started in wrestling, so the group helped me a lot. You know what I mean? Not to like still be on that, but the group helped me a lot that my senior year of wrestling, I literally did not care anymore. You know, like I was like, this is my last year of, I mean, my senior year of high school. I think I said wrestling. My senior year of high school, I didn't care anymore. I freely started to talk about, like, you guys literally helped me to like be free about liking wrestling. So that was when WrestleMania was going to Florida. I had a real life friend, you know, not a real life friend, but a friend from in person, a childhood friend that he lived in Florida. So I was going to go down there with him and we were going to go to WrestleMania together. So ended up meeting one of my literally best friends who turned into my tag team partner, Jesse or Kit Raff as on the Indies, you know. So we were seniors in high school. I was a senior. He was a year below me. And I just started talking about how I was going to WrestleMania, you know, to like one of my teachers, you know, because they were like, oh, why won't you be in school next week? And I was like, I'm out. I'm going on vacation. I'm going to Florida. I'm going to WrestleMania. So then Kit Raff overheard me at the time. And, you know, wrestling's very, it was still, you know, as we were just talking about, it wasn't popular. So he literally comes over and whispers to me like, you're a wrestling fan? And I'm like, yeah. I was like, yeah. He's like, you're going to WrestleMania? I was like, yeah. He's like, oh shit, that's cool. He's like, I haven't watched wrestling in a little bit, but like he was big Attitude Era fan, you know, and everything, Ruthless Aggression, but stopped watching for a bit. But this is when CM Punk, he started watching when CM Punk was starting to be at the top, you know, like Money in the Bank top type of stuff. He was like, oh, I started watching it recently, and like, I really like this CM Punk guy and Sheamus. That was his too, you know.
Very random too.
I know. Well, he's Irish, so that was his thing, you know. He was Irish and to his roots. So Sheamus was like his, like, oh my god. But so yeah, we connected there, and then, you know, literally to the point that we started watching it together, like hanging out, watching it together, you know. And then even one time towards like the end of that school year, I made a bet with him. Daniel Bryan, you know, started to get big at that time with the burgundy yes, yes, yes shirt. So I told him for a day that we were able to wear regular clothes to school, not uniform, we're going to wear wrestling shirts to school together. And so we did that. We wore shirts together. He wore a Sheamus. I wore my Daniel Bryan shirt. And this is literally after WrestleMania 28, where Sheamus beat Daniel Bryan in like, you know, 18 seconds. So, yeah. So, but so besides that, fast forward to like a year later, 2 years later, you know, I went to WrestleMania 29. So 2 years in a row, literally after that, I knew I wanted to do wrestling, always did, you know, even throughout discussion boards, I always knew I wanted to do wrestling, just didn't know when. So he wanted to be a pro wrestler too. That was his thing, you know? So literally we like, I dropped out of school, went to WrestleMania 29. The next day it was like, forget school, I'm going to wrestling school. So we just started looking up ways of how to do this together. And then we were going to move to Kentucky or Kansas to go to OVW, because at that time it was like the school, you know. So we wanted to go there, but then we looked up wrestling schools in Scranton, Pennsylvania. That's where we were living at. And there's literally one right like 5 minutes away from both of our houses. So yeah, that was April 2014 we started, like about March 2014, and then started training then.
So by the time this episode goes out, it will be 10 years since you started literally training. That's scary how time has flown. But
for real.
So Scranton, of course, the Electric City. I watched the Office. So being 5 minutes down the road, was that more of a case of, right, we'll try it, and if it doesn't work out, okay, I've tried it. But instead of, if you did it 5 minutes down the road, you're like, right, this is definitely what I want to do, you could kind of expand further. Was this your kind of jumping off point, was getting to school nearby?
So like, that was the thing, like, I think it was, so I think at that point it was WrestleMania 30, literally, because it was like March, April, like, and like we started middle of April. So we had an interview with our teacher, our trainer. So we reached out to him via email. He was like, just come in, you know, we'll talk, see how things go. He did things very professional, you know. It wasn't just like you walk in and, you know, so that was his thing too. He knew there was guys that would be like walking in, get right into the ring, and like 5 minutes later, they're like, I'm done. So he sat us down, you know, talked about our goals, things that, and third, literally a job interview. And yeah, once we see the ring, I think it was like open ring. So we saw some of the guys training, and we were like, yeah, no, like, this is it, you know, like, this is it. So offered us like, they had a tryout going on before the WrestleMania show. So they would do like a show before the WrestleMania, like before pay-per-views, and then they'll have all the fans stay and watch the pay-per-view as well too. But this one was WrestleMania, so, you know, it was a big one. So we had a tryout before the actual show, so we were there hella early. And yeah, I remember, like, I was in shape at that time. I was going to the gym, you know, like, once we knew, like, I dropped out of school, I knew, like, I wanted to do this. I started to get my working out going. My partner, on the other hand, was not. And he had a rougher time than me. And he ended up throwing up midway through. But no one knew, because he's a sly cat. Kit Raff, obviously, as a cat. But sly cat, he threw up in the bathroom and came back and just kept it going, you know, as if nothing happened. But yeah, after that, after our first day, we were like, oh, this is it, you know, like, once we got into the ring, like, even before then, when we were just watching the guys train, we were like, we left that day like, oh, we know we could do this, you know, like, we know, like, this is what we want to do.
it just clicked for you at that point.
And... Yeah. You know, and definitely like helping with all the like, you know, promos and stuff. And like, I used to do some, I don't know if you guys ever seen, but like, I'll do like, I think I was plugging it in later into the OSW chat, but like, I was doing some like at home wrestling, you know, like our own production, you know, like backyard wrestling, but we were doing it inside of my house. So it was like, you know, in my living room. And yeah, so like doing that and having those characters, like playing characters that, and like, I always knew I wanted to do it in the ring, you know?
Were you aware of a indie scene around you then? Or when you found out about the school, were you aware that there was a viable indie scene outside of your Ring of Honor or your big indies around about
honestly,
that time?
No, like, that's the thing about me with wrestling. Like, you hear all these people talk about, like, oh, yeah, like, I was watching Japanese tapes since I was a kid and this, that, and the third, like, watching ROH tapes. And, like, that wasn't me. All I knew was WWE, honestly, and TNA. That's all I knew. So, like, I went to one indie show. I went to a House of Glory show in New York one time. And, you know, Kevin Steen was there. And Matt Stryker was there. I remember meeting them. And that was like right before like August or so the year before. So that was my only like knowledge of indies. So, but that was, I went there as a fan. So it was cool, you know, it was awesome. I got to see some people like who like now are on TV. Honestly, like I remember seeing from Private Party, Mark Quinn, on AEW Now, like he had a match on there too. Like, and you know, Amazing Red and Crimson were like main event type of stuff there. So that was like my first thing of indies, but I didn't know there was more, you know, I was very uneducated.
I suppose it's the same when we were talking about the Bebo days and that, and it was like a little corner. We the advent of the internet means that I can just go on YouTube and I can see one of your more recent matches in less than 3 minutes, which is insane to think about. But back in our day, back in our day, yeah, I was the same. Everyone was going about tape trading, and I'm up in the northeast of Scotland going, who has these tapes? I mean, who has them? And then later on, realized and going, this is just piracy. This is what we're told not to do.
yeah, literally. You don't think it's real, and then I guess it was real, you know. But you really had to dive into that corner of wrestling to really get into it.
But yeah, seeing those kind of guys. I mean, I know for myself, like my first ever indie show that I went to, had Nikki Cross on it. And Emerson Jane, who was over for Game Changer recently.
Yeah.
So when you go back and think, God, that was what, 12 years ago, and now look at them, and they're in the WWE, and they're worldwide wrestlers. It's and you got to see Kevin Steen, which, I mean, Kevin Owens is probably one of my favorites right now. And
that was insane to, like, you know, because I didn't know who he was, but he was a big name on that show, you know, like. They brought him out as like a surprise and everyone freaked out, I remember. And I remember me not knowing who the hell this guy is, you know, but he was hella cool though. Even then I was like, holy shit, you know?
So from there, then you got to 2014, then you've started the training.
Yeah.
Cage Match says your first match was in 2015 in January. It could be wrong.
That's a lie. It is a lie.
Okay. Debut match. No, then.
November 23rd. 2014, so 6 months. So 6 months after I started training, and it was against my best friend. So since Kit Raft. So since we like started training together, my trainer thought it would be best that instead of doing a tag team match, like we had a one-on-one match against each other. And boy, I wish there's footage of that, because there was on YouTube for a long time, and then I don't know, the school took it down. That we went to, you know, I wish I had recorded it, you know, on my own to like have it. But honestly, every step by step type of match, it wasn't nothing crazy. I did a frog splash, which was completely horrendous. I think I did just a regular like Jimmy Five Sloka splash, to be honest with you. But I just remember having a lot of friends and family there, like from both sides of us, like his family and friends, my families and friends. So it was very hyped. It was great energy to it. But the match itself was very clothesline, body slam, elbow, you know, like very step by step and nothing crazy at that time.
6 months though, that's not long at all. So either you're a freak athlete or you're
we were persistent. We were persistent. Like we wanted to be in the ring. Like we wanted to have our first match like ASAP, you know, like because at that time, you know, we started to pay our dues and we would then have to start going to that's when my started getting into indie wrestling was when I started training, because we would have to drive 2 hours out just to literally, I remember the first one, like we had just started training. My trainer made us drive out about two and a half hours to this rundown, sorry, not rundown, but just middle of the woods type of indie show. And it was good. It was cool. It was good. But like we had to be there at like so early, like 9, 10. You know, so we had to leave at about 7 a.m., had to be up about 6, drive there. And our first experience is just meeting this guy man named Wolfman, and eyebrows out to here, tatted head, fucking, you know, just out of shape, dude, and like smelled like, oh my God. Coolest guy, though. Amazing guy. Eyes are one way's this way, one way's that way. And he's just like, oh yeah. And then the ring wasn't even there. So we got there so early for no reason. Didn't get started until about like 1 o'clock. So we're just hanging out with this guy for like 3 hours, just talking to him. And so like after that, but then when the show started and everything started, we were like, oh, you know, we got like, this is like, we felt that rush, that energy, you know, of like, performing in the crowd, getting to see our like trainer perform and everything. And that's when we were like, oh, we got to. And then we started being his entourage later on. So like more throughout our training, when he would bring us to the indie shows, you know, we'll help set up, break down, but we actually started to get a spot in the show as like his entourage. So like he would like play this very Lex Luthery character, you know, but like one person was his hairspray guy. Another person was his their own filmtographer. Another person was his stylist, you know. Another person held a mirror for him, you know, so he could see himself and everything on the way to the ring. And then, so yeah, so once we started to get that more experience as well too, that's when we were like, oh, okay.
I'm just imagining you're going to end that story with Wolfman. He was going to be the top champion. He's gonna come out.
Oh man. he was a champion at the other promotion. So he was big. So at the promotion that we helped out first, I think he was over there, but he was part of a tag team, I think. And then the show where we started to be the entourage at the other promotion, Triple WA it was called. He was like the top man there. Like the crowd went crazy for him there. Like Wolf, oh, it was a whole ordeal. I loved it.
That's the best thing about wrestling is some of the oddest cats can be like the biggest things, and then they'll go out and do their shopping on Monday, and nobody will know who this guy is, but there'll be one person that goes past and goes, Wolfman.
Yeah, Wolfman, yeah. It was crazy because I actually seen him in Dallas for WrestleMania a couple of years ago. And he was down there for WrestleMania weekend. And I was like, it's been years since then. I was like, you remember me? He's like, yeah. And I was like, oh, shit. That's what's up. Yeah. But yeah.
Wolf never forgets. Okay. So 2014 is your debut, 6 months in, which yeah, blows my mind. I think that's it was 6 months.
Oh, another thing to say, yeah. For 6 months, like we were going to training like 3 days. Like,
oh, all right, okay. So it wasn't like
we were only supposed to go. We were supposed to go once a week. That was like it was like one beginner's class, intermediate advanced class, and then an open ring kind of day. But so we took advantage. we got our beginner's class. Then we started showing up the open ring, even though we couldn't do much, we didn't know much. So then the trainer saw our efforts at that. And then he was just like, he bumped us up, you know, to intermediate advanced. So we were starting to go there like within 3 months, I think, intermediate advanced, boom. And then we would still go to beginner's training to just help out. So then that's how we were still getting our 3 days worth of training in as well too.
So you're condensing 18 months into six kind of thing.
Literally,
that,
yeah.
That seems a bit more realistic. I don't know. I've never taken a bump in my life. I'm more than happy just to be behind the microphone. That'll do me.
Screaming. At least one.
I always have the dream. There's always like the moment where you think, I'm never going to do it. And then you look at, when you go to an indie show, you go, you know, just give it, throw an elbow drop. That'd be ace.
Yeah.
And then I get up and my knees click and you go, no, probably not.
I'm good.
let's just stick with the phone. Let's just do the recording instead. So when I was going through your cage match profile, because this is the only way you can really do research nowadays, it seems.
Yeah.
It's already incorrect, so it's always a good start. we're going by then, you started 2014, and it wasn't long before, was it always in mind for yourself and Kit Raff to be a team? Was that the initial goal? Or was there any single aspiration?
Yeah, we wanted to be a team. Like, when we were pretty upset when we were told we were going to be singles for our debut, which was fine, you know, but that was the goal. We always wanted to be a team.
So it wasn't long before you guys were in tag team matches for titles and becoming champions. I think it was October 2015. So less than a year, you guys were...
Yeah.
We're tag team champions. Where was it? PPW, I think it was.
Or GSW, Grand GSW. Slam, possibly. PPW, I became... So that was another... PPW booked me, but then they wouldn't... Something, you know, so that was one thing. Like, they would just... They try to push me as singles, and then they didn't really want to book my partner, which was fine. But doing that... But other GSW is where tag team was like... You know, that's GSW. We started helping out, paying our dues there too, and just got closer and closer to like everyone there. And then, that's where like our tag team stuff actually started.
That's it. Yeah. October GCW, and then April was PPW and No Limits title. So, yeah. So you were kind of, you were double dipping. You had the singles run over there, you had the tag team run on one side. Did you have a preference at that time? I mean, you're a year in. So, Did you be able to register having a preference between singles and tag?
No, I mean, at the time, no. Like, I think a little bit of me wanted to do singles more because I was like, you know, maybe, you know, I was like, in the future, like, what if, like, we split up? And then so I have this experience, you know? But then, like, I feel like the more I started to do singles, I was like, I have more fun when I do tag team matches. I used to be so stressed. I remember doing singles matches that, when we were doing tag team matches, it was easy to like just have someone pick up the rest of the work and just, you know, do some stuff and then come, and you didn't have to remember so much, you know, especially being a year in. Like, but it's crazy because now kids nowadays, they're a year in and they're fucking doing all this move within 1 year, and I'm like, how do you ever remember that? But yeah.
it's half the work, I suppose. There's probably a more mental aspect to it in tag team, but it's less physical because you don't have to get hurt as much, which is nice. Going through 2015, the incorrect data I've got here. I've also got a match with Mark Quinn, who you mentioned earlier, was that probably one of your first big name opponents? I'm just having a quick.
It was. I remember, like, because I had seen him in House of Glory, and I was like, this dude, and he just kept on getting better. And I was like, this dude is so good, you know, like, he was very athletic, very indie-like, very doing the flips and everything. And I'm athletic-ish, but I can't be doing, I don't do the flips and everything, you know, like he could, you know, so it was very, like, it was a challenge for me, but, like, to going into the match, but once we did the match, it was very easy.
You talked about being like anxiety when you're doing singles matches? Is there a part of that when you're against a Mark Quinn who you saw wrestle before you were a wrestler? Is there any bit of starstruck that you get as well? Because I mean, looking at your, we will get onto obviously the SmackDown thing.
Yeah.
But is there any, like, in that early days where you're like, oh my god, I'm facing a guy that I've seen wrestle. I know who this guy is. I've seen this guy on TV.
Yeah.
Did that just pile onto your anxiety as well?
It does. It does big time. Even not to jump a few years, but I don't know. I don't even think a cage match has it even written down. But I wrestled Alex Shelley like years, like a couple of years ago now. I think 2 years ago now. But yeah, and that was big for me at the time, you know, and my anxiety kicked my ass before that match. Even during the match, it kicked my ass. So it wasn't my best showing. But, you know, so like, yeah, it was big time.
Right. I'm gonna close tape cage match though. I'm gonna close it because I don't want to plug them.
No, you're good.
They've had enough plugging over the last couple of weeks due to the internet. So we'll just leave it at that. I've still got notes though, so it's all good. So I mean, you got the anxiety. We're not going to focus on it too much, like not going to labor on it. But is that how you kind of use like your all that Keita Murray character to kind of just cover that anxiety by being a bit more larger in life? You had the orange soda, you had all that kind of energy about you. Was that just masking the cracks of the anxiety?
It was, you know, and it was very not easy to get over with the fans, but the fans loved it, you know, like especially at that time where nostalgia was getting big and bigger and bigger, and you know, the 90s thing was the thing, so I grabbed right onto it, you know. And so I was like, you know, it's something popular now. Let me run with this, you know?
Mm-hmm. I mean, I loved it. I mean, I'm of the age where Keenan and Kel was my afternoon viewing. So to see you come out with your soda and all that kind of stuff. Because I'm old as well, my second thought was, God, I hope he doesn't spill that. That's going to be sticky. So sticky.
I know. And that's why I wasn't a big, people weren't a big fan of me sometimes. So yeah, they it would get in the ring, it would get a little bit sticky. Some people get pissed at me promoters wise for everything, where you know I ruined their canvas, you know, of the ring, and my bad. But it was just me trying to do my thing. I didn't know better, you know. and then actually, the orange soda itself would started to gas me out because I'm drinking soda right before having to do some cardio, basically. So I'll be very bloated, you know, and like just gas throughout the match, you know. So I kind of started to switch it and use water and put some dye in there to hide the fact of I'm not drinking orange soda. But yeah.
That's the secrets of the ring we're getting from this podcast here. We found out that the orange soda wasn't actually orange soda.
Orange soda. It was in the first couple of years, but towards the end, it wasn't.
So we're going to jump around then because we've got matches noted for, like, against names I've heard of. Not to say I haven't heard of a lot of your opponents because it's just not the scene I'm in. But guys like Zicky Dice, I noticed, popped up there as opponents, and which hearing about him on things TNA and Impact Wrestling, whatever you want to call it, these are big opportunities. We'll go to 2018. So I think that's an important plot point in the Keita Murray story.
Yes.
Which was, first off, a debut in NXT, which would have been black and gold at the time. It was the original recipe NXT. Oh, no, the second recipe, not the game show one, which I still
love. Yeah, the second, yeah.
How did that come about then? So how did you end up in NXT? That was crazy.
So, you know, I did the usual... you know, send your, like, they were coming to Sacramento or something before. I think I reached out to them. I didn't get anything for that, but then they still had my info, so they had contacted me to come down to Los Angeles. So I was up in Sacramento. It's about a 6-hour drive, you know, down to Los Angeles. So, you know, California is one big, it's a state, but, you know, it's big, so... Sacramento up here, Los Angeles down here. So I went down there and I remember it was for 4 days because that's when they were doing SmackDown. SmackDown on Tuesday. So it was Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Tuesday. So Saturday, NXT was the first day of me being there. And I don't know. I remember being, I wasn't even like, so, when you're there as an extra, you're just hanging out, like you get some time before the show comes on to hang out by the ring, And I just remember, I don't know, something came about me that there's Triple H right there and Matt Bloom. So this is like when Matt Bloom just started taking over like the coaching and, being the man of NXT, like the creative and everything. And they're right there by the barricade, outside of the ring by the barricade. So, and I'm on the other side of the barricade where the fans are, So I just go over. I'm like, I'm just going to introduce myself. What's going to be the worst, So I guess they already had the match planned out with Lars and someone else. And I just say, hey, I think I said hello to Triple H first, or I don't know, whoever. But I said, hello, Mr. He had his back turned. I'm like, Mr. Bloom. He turns around. He's like, what the, I'm like, how's it going? I'm Keita, Keita Murray. He's like, Miss Matt Bloom. And then all of a sudden he goes, okay, so he said hello. He turns around like to his back. I'm looking at his back again. Then he turns back around to me and he's like, hold on, hold on. So the guy who was supposed to be in the match with Lars is standing right next to me, and I feel so bad, but I didn't mean this. And he goes, actually, we're gonna make a change. We're gonna switch. I'm sorry to the other guy, but we're gonna go with him. It talking about me, like to be in the match. And I'm like, what the fuck? All I said was hello, So yeah, that was like crazy. Which, at the end of the day, I think what so he oh what he did say is he's gonna get more sympathy talking about me.
Right.
So, and I think that because at this time it was Lars Sullivan and Keith Lee starting their feud. So, not for nothing, race, not racism, but just, it helps in a big way. It's not racism. Let me not say racism,
No,
because
no.
not,
It's the
but
symbolism of it, kind of thing.
it's
That's
symbolism,
a
yes.
nice way we say that word.
Exactly.
Symbolism of it, yeah.
Symbolism of it. So Keith Lee was supposed to make the save after the match anyway. So, Lars was supposed to beat down the opponent down after winning. Keith Lee comes out, makes a save, does his thing with Lars. So then me being a black man, it just makes sense, I guess, in a way. It was never told to me, but it makes sense in a way that Keith Lee making the save on a black kid, basically, because I was a kid, a black kid getting beat down by this big giant white man, would definitely get more sympathy than the white man beating down this white man because the other guy was white, and then Keith Lee making the save. So in all, that's where I feel like I got my spot,
Yeah. I mean, you don't know if it's punishment or as well. I mean, you interrupted Triple H and
That too. It could have been
Albert.
that too. It could have been that too, literally. Yeah, you're right. I never even thought about that, but you're
You
right.
got your shot though. That's the most important thing. I mean, it's
Exactly.
if you didn't say hello, you wouldn't have had it. Possibly he
Exactly.
wouldn't been spotted by other promoters in that area, and it just it all works out in the end.
Yeah.
Was this after you moved pretty much across the country as well
Yeah.
to do that?
So 2017, I moved across the country from Scranton to Sacramento.
I mean, I know nothing about geography, especially about the US. So it could be 2 hours apart. It could be 18. I have no
Oh,
idea.
it
But
was
yeah.
3 days of driving. So yeah, that far apart. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. And that's all. Was it mostly due to wrestling, or was there any?
Real life job, had an opportunity. I was working insurance. They had a office open in Sacramento. So I was stuck in my house for like 2, 3 days. I remember, I think that March, or February, due to snow. And I had it with snow. I was like, no, like I hate this weather. And I actually like, I felt like I wasn't pretty much going anywhere in wrestling. Maybe I would have, you never know. But wrestling was becoming like, it was just hard there. I felt like I had to get out of that area too for wrestling. So it definitely helped, you know. But I definitely just wanted to move to California. That was like the main thing. I just wanted to get out of my town and move.
You mentioned insurance. That's the most boring job in the world. That is my real job. That's my shoot job, and it is bloody boring. But anyway, it pays the bills.
I was doing claims.
That was even worse.
That's why I'm not with that job anymore. But help me move. So
exactly. I mean, for me, it paid. Technically, this is, I'm on my work PC doing this, so it is okay. paid in many ways, and also for my wall of crap behind me.
I love it.
but it's just one of those bored things. But we move on to SmackDown. Then we'll get SmackDown in here. You know, you're just facing you and what was it? You're Wayne, were you? You were Wayne and Dane Bryant.
Wayne and Dane, I believe. Yeah.
Against The Miz. You know, two-time Grand Slam winner in WWE against Shane McMahon, the former boss's son. Oh, it's a very dicey grind I don't want to go on to.
Yeah.
But The Miz and Shane McMahon, that's a mad thing to tick off.
Literally.
Just in general. And you won.
Yeah, and I won. That's what I was going to say, and I won, which the jobbers never win, so what the fuck? That was a crazy experience. Just that whole weekend, you know. So Saturday was NXT, Sunday was Survivor Series. I got to be a part of like being a medic during the Charlotte and Ronda Rousey thingy. So that's actually where my phone blew up because no one saw the NXT stuff yet. So like that was pre-tape. I remember literally, not to like, I'll get to SmackDown, but I remember having my phone in my pocket at the same time I'm out there in the ring. And I just feel my phone vibrating. And I'm in the middle of the ring doing this thing. And I knew that's where everyone's like, oh, Keita. So that was Sunday. Monday was Raw. I did get to do another medic spot. I forget even with who, to be honest. But it was never even actually shown. I think they cut to commercial before we even got a chance to go out there. And then that's when Tuesday. So Tuesday happened where... Usually when you're extras, so, you know, with everything being busy throughout the week, Saturday, Sunday, Monday, Monday is a live show. So, but Tuesdays were live too at that time too. Mm-hmm. So that's when they started doing SmackDown Live. We still got to do our trial match before everything because it's a little bit calmer, you know. So they give you 5-minute match. Usually it's one-on-one, I believe. In this one, they did a 5-minute tag team match. So it was me and Eli, my partner, against two other guys, I forget. And you know, we run a quick 5-minute match and so, and then they pull us after. But even beforehand, we get the Iggy, you know, the Iggy, like, hey, heads up, like, don't get hurt in this 5 minutes. Chill out, you know? We're like, okay, cool. So then once we do the 5-minute match, we leave the ring. He's like, okay, so we have a spot for you guys. You know, we're doing this thing with Shane and The Miz where they were doing the greatest in the world or whatever, that thingy. You know, so they were like cold greatest in the world. You know, they were feuding, but they were trying to form a tag team. And they're like, so we're going to give you a spot in that segment, like as a tag team match, you know. And then... I don't even remember when they told us we were winning or so, but after just hearing that, like being a part, like having a match, I was like, what, you know, against these people, I'm like, what? But being with The Miz, working with The Miz was incredible. Was like, the man is so professional, you know, going, because he had the whole promo beforehand. So like he's doing the Miz talk or whatever with Shane. So he had a promo beforehand, had to remember all these lines, you know. Got a chance to talk to him beforehand. He was like, you guys excited? You know, we're like, yeah. He's like, good. You know, you guys should be. Like, this is a big thing. And we're like, yeah, you know. And then Shane comes over, starts running the thing with The Miz or so. And then I remember one thing where they were like, oh, you know, your dad wants you to do this or something, because Shane wanted to do something else, but they were like, no, your dad wants this. And Shane's like, do you know who the fuck I am? Like, type of shit. Like, I'm gonna do whatever the fuck I want to do. And that was an insight to like, ooh, this is real life shit, you know? So that was cool, you know, to see like that interaction. And yeah, it's, I don't know, now it's kind of a blur, but like everything lean, like, you know, we get dressed, you know, we're in the gorilla position beforehand, you know, the whole thing's going, the promo. And then they give us our cue to like, okay, you guys are out. I remember them telling us like, oh yeah, you guys are going to be the Bryant brothers before that. That's one thing. It was Dean Malenko and he was our agent, you know, and he's like, oh, you guys are going to be the Bryant brothers, Wayne, Dane. They're like, you know why you're the Bryant brothers, right? And we're like, we're at the Staples Center. So we're like, yeah, it's Kobe Bryant, right? They're like, yeah. We look nothing alike, but that was their little joke of, we're at the Staples Center, home of the Lakers, Kobe Bryant, the Bryant brothers. Like, you know, so that's a little thing about that name. But yeah, we go out there. I was supposed to have I was actually supposed to get in the ring, you know, have a little spot. So I never actually got a chance to go inside the ring. Like, I did go inside the ring, boom, and then straight to the corner, you know. I was supposed to get thrown in by the Miz after he beats up my partner. You know, he throws me in, beats me up a little bit, throws me back out, and then my partner gets the pin on him, you know. But I guess once the match started, they had overrun the time on the promo. So then literally it's like, I remember they were like 90 seconds, you know, or whatever. So, and the Miz just comes over to me and goes, I'm sorry. And then he like goes, and then the pinfall happens. And then I remember one note, they were like, when you guys win, you better act like you won the World Series, like the Super Bowl. Like, you better act like it's the most biggest thing that you ever did. And we were like, okay, we got this, you know? Like, yeah, it was crazy. It was good. It was nice. And then Triple H, once we got in the back, he was there, and we were like, thank you, sir. Vince was in his little corner with his headset, you know, as they always say he is. And it's a real thing, he is. We just walked over like, thank you. He's like, and that was it.
So you can also say then you beat the Miz and Shane McMahon without breaking a sweat, which I think is all the more impressive.
Exactly. I didn't even take one bump and I got my biggest paycheck. No, I'm joking.
And now that every promoter afterwards could put the wee as seen on WWE on their show posters. That's
literally. It got me booked after that, so it did help, yeah.
So
there was one promotion in the area that was bigger, you know, in Sacramento that wouldn't book me. And then once I got that spot on there, they're like, you available to the next show? And I'm like, sure am.
My price is higher now because I'm a former WWE superstar. Uh-huh. At least in 50 years, you can have that. And obviously, hopefully, you will have more accolades. But if everything doesn't work out, you have former WWE superstar Keita Murray on the WrestleCon.
I'm undefeated, and I'm good. You know.
Exactly. So moving on from there, then, like I said, the like you just said, the bookings came in. Former WWE star and what have you, and wrestling started to really explode. Especially 2020 into 2021, and then there's a pandemic, which didn't really help things.
But
did you find that there was a more influx of your bigger promotions? I know that you end up working with New Japan Pro Wrestling Strong, and I don't know if you've done AEW Dark or anything like that, but you find that there was a bit more of opportunities available. Did you find your weekends were getting more and more full off the back of that?
Yeah. So I actually it wasn't right after that. It took a little bit, about a year. I moved to Los Angeles. So I was still doing the Sacramento, Northern California area. Then I moved to Los Angeles in 2019, right before the pandemic. And then that's when things started to actually start happening for me. But then I think it came with, so at the time I was in a change because, you know, I had just done this stuff with WWE last year. So I was still holding on to like my, all that stuff, but I knew it was starting to dim down, you know, like it was starting to get played out. You know, there's sometimes I would be in different crowd areas that, you know, they would boo me because I think I was too babyface. It was like kind of like too much John Cena, you know? So they would start to boo me and I'm over here trying to be a big babyface and it wasn't working. So I knew something had to change and I knew I had to become more of a serious wrestler, you know, but like I know the days of, it's crazy because I feel like big gimmicks are coming back, but it was a weird time period at that time where gimmicks were whack, like no big gimmicks. Yeah. Like we did do big black trunks, you know, indie wrestler. So I didn't want to be that, but I knew I had to be a more serious wrestler. So yeah. So when I moved to Los Angeles, I forget how I started getting the New Japan stuff, but I just remember just I was doing the I was never in the dojo, but I started doing the young, like the ringside stuff during the COVID tapings that they had here. And that just kind of got my foot in the door. And that's how I actually started to get booked with New Japan as well, too.
And I was looking through your list of opponents from that point onwards. You had likes of Chris Bay, QT Marshall, and Bullet Club. And it's again, like it was a mind-blowing thing that 10 years ago, here we were on Bebo and message boards speaking about wrestling. And then fast forward, you're wrestling some of the biggest names in the world. And you're on the PWI 500 and all that kind of stuff. And it's really cool. It's just really cool to see that.
Yeah, thank you. It's insane. Yeah.
Especially as you were the guy I roasted 10 years ago on YouTube. So it's really just
right. Now I get to blow it back in your face, like, huh?
I know. Here I am with a middling podcast and I'm just speaking to probably one of the possibly underrated talents in the US, and you know, okay. Who's laughing now?
For real.
So like I said, we were gonna speak about Effy's big gay brunch, but we don't know what match you've got. But we know that something is on the horizon. You know you're gonna be there WrestleMania weekend. But how did you get introduced to that? I mean, I know during the pandemic you came out as bisexual. I'll be perfectly honest.
Oh, that was a long time ago.
I'm perfectly honest. I'm going into a realm of stuff I very underqualified to speak about. But, okay. Was that kind of how someone like Effy would be introduced to Keita Murray because of that, or were you already in touch with Effy through Game Changer or the Big Gay Brunch beforehand?
I think I forget. Honestly, I do forget how that all started out or so, but I do remember. So I came out in 2016, like 2 years into my career, and just I kind of kept it a little bit low key though-ish, you know, still came out. But then there was times where, yeah, I just started getting more like proud of myself and just like, okay, fuck it. This is who I am, you know, but, I feel like with Effy, so he knew my partner Kit Raff from then. Because my first big gay brunch was, I believe, Dallas. I think so. Or no, Chicago. Was Chicago. And around that time, I think GCW started to do shows in LA. So I was going there to help out. And, you know, and then that's when I started to, yeah, get to know Effy a lot more as well. So it was more like personal, like like more how you say it, organic, you know, growth.
Yeah.
Instead of just hitting him up and like him not really knowing who I am, it was just more like I like this guy, you know, like I'm gonna have him out, you know. So yeah.
Yeah, you got to know each other. It wasn't a case of right, I'm doing a big gay brunch. I need LGBTQ plus wrestlers. Oh, he's one of them. Kind of thing. It was a bit more natural than that. That's
exactly cool. Yeah.
But yeah, getting those opportunities, and we've got a bunch of questions I need to get through as well. I'm noticing,
no, it's okay.
Noticing our time here, but it's really cool to like say. I said it a couple of times on this 45 minutes an hour that we've been speaking. It's just great to see what you've accomplished in that time and the time that we've cross paths in the past, and just to see what you're doing now is just really just amazing. So
thank you, man. I was hoping, you know, I'll be somewhere further along, but it's okay. Like I don't mind being like considered one of the underrated talents, you know, on the indie scenes, because yeah, it's the truth. Like I know every time I go out there and I put on a match, like it's it's something that I take pride in, you know, every time. So even though I'm probably not where I'm at, where I wanted to be 10 years ago, I still love doing this shit. You know what I mean? And it's cool to fucking do it.
That's it. Right. Let's get into the questions then. I think it's a guy that also scanned your cage match profile. So some of them have been answered already. Memories of your matches, Do Davi, you've done that one. Memories of Zicky Dice. So I mentioned him earlier. How's that?
Real quick. That's my man. I met him in Chicago. Before I moved to California, like 2016, we were in like a scramble match. Then he's originally from California. So when I moved to California, we got booked in the middle of nowhere, Northern California. And we connected there. We will always stay and chat with each other. Like, we literally have FaceTime talks with each other. He's a man that works fucking hard. Like, and he's always wanted this, you know, as much as everybody else. And he literally puts his life on the line for this shit. Like, you know, you talk about someone with anxiety and overthinking, like, that's him, but that's his biggest success, is like his, you know, that puts us into his strengths. Like, I need to do this. This is how I'm going to make it. And him being on NWA, being the TV champ, him being on Impact, getting signed, like, I'm fucking proud of him, you know, like, knowing him from a real life, like, not even just working with him, but, you know, I even went to his pre-engagement party, like, didn't get the chance to go to his wedding because of COVID, but, like, you know, in real life, personal, like, that's my boy, and that man works so fucking hard, like, that no one knows, like, and, yeah, so, yeah, that's about Zicky Dice, my biggest memory.
It's AP Video who asked these questions. Talking about your debut match, we know that that's incorrect because you put 3-on-1 handicap match. We know that's wrong.
They talked about that triple. I saw this. So they talked about my handicap match. And I did want to talk about this one, right?
All right,
so
cool.
Go ahead. You can finish it, right?
Right. So 3-on-1. So memories of your debut match, January 17th, 2015, in PPW in a 3-on-1 handicap match with Cage. Your partners are John Valentine and Shogun Machete.
Shogun Machete, the fucking man. He had a hand in training me, you know, along with my trainer. So I love him. So underrated, you know, character gimmicks, wrestling wise, real life fucking black belt. So crazy, wacky dude, though. I love him. Johnny Valentine. Oh, my God. This was a guy that we started training with and was just in and out. He was one of those guys in and out of training, just gave it his all. Very Jeff Hardy like vibes, you know, but just nothing happened. But I remember I got my wisdom teeth taken out literally fucking the weekend before this show. And so I'm not supposed to do any physical activity or anything, but this is when I knew, like, I'm a fucking tough ass dude or whatever. Like, so like I go to the show, I don't think we're even booked really. Like, it was one of those, okay, not really booked, but then they needed this match. So then they chose 1, 2, 3, you know, us. And I just remember being like, okay, like, I'm not going to do much. It's 3-on-1. Like, how much am I going to fucking do? You know, so against a big guy, we're going to get squashed. So, you know, I remember my girlfriend at the time was like, no, no, no. And I'm like, shh. And literally, yeah. So I take one boot, I think, in the match, and I think a body slam, and I was fine, you know, but that's one thing. Yeah, I wrestled literally a few days after getting my wisdom teeth taken out, and where you're not supposed to do anything, but I sure damn did it.
Somebody say that yeah. took your wisdom with you.
I sure did.
We've got Fantasy Booker Podcast with a couple questions. I think it's the same guy, possibly, because it's the same kind of set questions. But memories of wrestling Shotzi Blackheart.
Oh, yeah. Okay, yeah. That was cool, because we've known each other in Northern California for a bit. So we wrestled down in Los Angeles. So it was just a good time, good vibe. I think I was a little bit rough with her, you know. I'm sorry, my hits were a little bit stiff, as they call it. So her it was a hard hitting match. She came back with a couple of stiff shots, but I like to say that, you know, I warmed her up to, like, you know, on the road that she was right before WWE and on the indies, because she was having a lot of intergender matches, you know. And, you know, she was doing some crazy shit too, like suicide dives onto chairs to the outside. So I like to say I toughened her up. No, I'm joking. But yeah, you know, I do remember being I don't know if she was upset or not, but, or if it was part of the aftermatch character. But once we got to the back, everything was cool. So, yeah.
You gave her the WWE rub to set her on her way. That was it.
Very good.
Memories of your wrestling death matches in MPW. MPU.
MPU, no peace underground. So those are always cool. Those were new because it wasn't in the ring all the time. I think I wrestled one time in the ring when they came to Vegas, but they were mostly in Florida. And that was my first experience of having to like rework my mind of wrestling, of how to be more creative and things of that nature. And most of them, so like death matches, yeah, like it wasn't crazy death matches though. Like the most of my matches were very calm, like hardcore matches, I would say. Right. But there was one I wrestled Ty Hill. I went through a door of light tubes, and that I wanted to experience light tubes at the time. My mom was there with my aunt. I don't know what the fuck I was thinking. But yeah, that wasn't something that was, she didn't go to a show of mine since my first match. And my first match was so fucking basic compared to this. And she didn't like my first match. She was like, I don't like you being hurt. Now she's seeing me go through a table of fucking light tubes and she's like, what the fuck? So I remember, yeah. and that's the only time I ever did something like that. But yeah, they were fun. They were always fun because you had to be creative, you know, with not having the ring, having weapons, you know, and also giving something that's different than what's going to happen later on in the show or with the actual crazy fucking death matches that people are going through, glass, fire, you know, all this and that. Like, so yeah. And what I do the most is the shower after fucking light tubes is the worst. So just so everyone knows too, yeah, those cuts that you get from the light tubes ain't fun. And when you have to shower after that, not fucking fun. That shit stings.
There's a guy, Deathmatch Wrestling there's a company in Scotland that started Bleeding Gums Wrestling, and they've done their first show. And I was speaking to the promoter of it for the podcast call, and there was a guy called Alton Thorne on the show, and his weapon of choice in death matches is stinging nettles. And it is the most disgusting thing I've ever heard. Everything else, I was kind of okay with, light tubes and what have you. But nettles was like, nah, that's too far. No.
I'm good.
And I saw pictures of the show, and there was like syringes going through eyelids. I was like, nah, no.
No, I don't mess with that. Nah. Oh my god, that's disgusting.
I'll stick to the wrestlers coming out and clapping their hands and going, come on guys, that'll do me.
That's literally,
oh no. God, don't know why I keep bringing it up. It actually gives me the fear every time I speak about it. Anyway, last question that we've got through here is memories of wrestling Kenta at New Japan Pro Wrestling in the dojo in California. I think, was that Battle Royal or was it 1-on-1?
That was a Battle Royal, so I think they might have gotten a little bit confused. So that was Battle Royal, I believe. Like, it was a number one contenders match for the Strong Championship. And yeah, so I never wrestled him 1-on-1. I don't even know if I got in the ring with him because I think I got eliminated by the time. It was the Battle Royal. So I got eliminated. Honestly, though, that's one thing. I never got eliminated, so I'm still there. And I told Rocky Romero I deserve a shot at the championship because I never got eliminated the correct way. I believe it was Mascara, I forget his name. It was one of the Lucha guys. So Lucha guys, you know, like, it's a different world for them. So he throws me through the middle rope and kicks me off the apron, you know. So, and then they tell me I'm eliminated, but I never actually got eliminated. So as of this day, never was eliminated from that Strong Survivor Battle Royal. And I earned my right to a number one contenders match. I mean, until a championship match.
So I mean, I think Kenta won it. So I think that's just you calling out Kenta going, nah, you're not the rightful winner. You've overstepped.
Exactly. Yeah, exactly. So yeah, time will, it'll come.
And we did get a question through Instagram from Ian Skinner. I don't know if you've heard of Ian Skinner.
Yeah.
He is one of the most creatively annoying people that I've ever met through wrestling. He's just amazing. But he has asked, because Shane McMahon was on the last Big Gay Brunch, asked if you have a favorite Scottish wrestler. So do you know much about the Scottish scene?
From people who follow me, so Shane McMahon, So brunch was so crazy that we didn't even get to say hello to each other. So like up until like so after we started messaging each other, like, oh, sorry, like things are so crazy to even get to say hello or what's up. So now we're friends, but when we were in person, we never even got to like actually meet. But Ian Skinner, I've been following for a long ass time, and like, yeah, very creative with him. I do. He'll probably be my favorite, honestly, because yeah, like I've been following him for a long time. I do. So yeah, hell yeah.
Yeah,
I don't.
I love him. He's just fantastic. We've had him on the show a few times, and by the time we got to episode four, we've done four chats with him. We gave up speaking about wrestling and did a whole episode on Austin Powers Gold Member. Because
Ah, I love Gold Member. Hell
yeah,
yeah.
we spent an hour speaking about Gold Member instead of wrestling. It was just a
You
blast. But
see,
anyway.
that's why he would be my favorite. So yeah.
So yeah, anyone else on the scene that, from over here that you've kept an eye on? I mean, again with Twitter and that, you can catch on YouTube, you can catch on by anyone from any scene nowadays, from Uganda to wherever.
Yeah, literally Uganda. Yeah. I don't know, just off the top of my head, and is Adam Bolt Scottish, in the Scottish area?
Adam Bolt.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't think so. If he is, I haven't heard of him, which is not a good sign for him. I'm joking. He's got more followers than me on Twitter. He's British, so he's probably English.
Gotcha. Okay.
But no, you are keeping an eye on the UK, though. There's a little bit of a scene
A
here
little, yeah.
that, yeah.
Yeah, I love to go out there sometimes, so hell yeah. I'll,
I would
even if I have to
say.
get myself out there.
I would say you're welcome at my spare room, but I'm in the Northeast. I'm hours away from. I've got WrestleZone near me. That's about it. So you're probably better in the Central
Okay.
Belt, Glasgow area. But
Okay, bet.
just to make you aware. I mean, I think Shane McMahon possibly would have happened by now, but by the time this episode comes out, but he's got a Pride show, coming. No, I'm gonna Google it just to
Okay.
make sure. If it's a future date, I can plug it. July. Well, in the
July,
future,
okay.
21st of July, 2024, he's got a show in Glasgow that he's doing a Pride show. So, just if you want to get in touch with him, Charles Crowley's on the show. There's some big names to get a hold of.
I will.
So, looking ahead to the future, at the moment, like I say, in the future is WrestleMania weekend, even though we're weeks away from it as of recording. Have you got any? You say you hadn't really made it to where you want to be. What's your kind of short-term plans, which is what you want to achieve this year.
I like to be, so it's always to be signed, but at this day and age, it's like, I feel like I am traveling every week, so I can't really even like say that. Like, I've literally like I'm traveling every week, but I would like to have wrestling as my only source of income, if anything, in that way. So whether it be signed somewhere or anything, or just doing it so often that I'm getting paid for it. I would like to be, instead of being underrated, I would like to be someone who's popping off, on social media and everything, like, and not being forgotten about, but just not being like, oh yeah, Keita, like, he's great, he's awesome, but like, he's underrated. Like, that's the part that's kind of getting to me a little bit now. It's like, okay, when do I stop being underrated, and when do y'all actually start? Because y'all know I'm good, you know what I mean? It's like, it's not like I ever hear bad things, oh, he's a bad performer. Like, no, like, people know that I go out there and I do good, but it's like, yeah, when do I stop being underrated, and when do I start being like that guy in the indie scenes that's like, we need him on my show, so that's the goal. That's the goal.
So if people want to find out more about Keita Murray, then where can people find out more? Where's social media, YouTube, just all your plugs, all your links, all your merch? Get on it.
Social media, so Twitter or X, whatever, and Instagram, it's Keita Your Heart, KEITAYOURHEART. YouTube, you could literally just look up Keita Murray versus, a whole bunch of videos will pop up. So that's another way to see me on YouTube. I do have a page, I just don't really update it, and it's literally has the same username from the OSW days. So I don't really like to, but it's called YouTube.littleZ16. So that was me 18,000 years ago. So, but yeah, I have a few of my matches are up on there, but if you literally just type in Keita Murray versus on wrestling, a whole bunch of stuff pops up. And then Facebook, just Keita Murray. I try to keep that a little balanced. So of like fans that I have met in person and wrestlers and some family. So if it's a fan or so that I've never really met or anything, I might not really, you know, confirm that request up until I meet them. I just don't want to get random messages or so, like, and put it. I have a lot of anxiety. Overflowing messages kind of get me crazy. So I just kind of keep it a little bit chill. And merchandise. I have a page on stiffblade.com, stiffblade.com. Merchandise on there, so stiffblade.com. That's where I have some stuff at.
So I'm gonna look at it now. That's a very dodgy name for a website for me to put into my work PC here, but we'll go with it.
I know.
there's some cool stuff on here.
Cool. So they have a good amount of collaborations with a lot of people, but choose my stuff. No joke.
Amazing. Well, I'm glad that we've finally got this chat done after so many years of knowing each other and me being able to not track you. I'm not stalking you, but be able to keep an eye on what you do. Able to do this. And I'm hoping people that are watching this, and like I said, it's outside of the usual Scottish wrestling stuff, but it's an important episode that I wanted to at least get done during this podcasting thing. Hopefully when this comes out, you'll have a humongous match at Effy's Big Gay Brunch. If you've just got a match itself, I think that's probably a cool thing to have. It's a payday at the end of the day. But it's been an absolute blast. I'm glad that you've done well. And hopefully next time we speak, it'll be in our 10 years down the line, and you've got all the gold and you're in the Hall of Fame already and all that good stuff.
Let's go. Let's go. Let's bring it to real life. Thank you.
Perfect. Well, have a good one.
You too. Thank you, Billy. It was a pleasure.